We're back in the office. It's the one you've all been waiting for. Hashtag Ask Divers Ready. Thank you so much to everyone who submitted your questions. Let's do this thing. Ladies and gentlemen, what's going on? Welcome to Divers Ready. My name is James. It is so great to see all of your smiling faces. We've been on the road for a couple of weeks, but we're back in the office. It's Monday, and you know that that means it's Mouthpiece Monday. So if you're new to this channel, welcome. I'm a professional diving instructor and digital content creator, and we make videos with one simple goal in mind: to help make you a better scuba diver. So just have a look down there. You see that little red subscribe button? Give it a click, see how it feels. Click on the little bell icon, and that way you'll never miss any of our content. And you're not gonna want to, because we have a ton of great videos lined up for you. Starting with tomorrow. It's Tuesday, it's DEMA week. That means we're packing the car up, making the 3-hour drive north to Orlando, and gonna be camped out at the scuba industry's biggest trade show, the DEMA show. So we can't wait for that. We've got meetings lined up all week long with the biggest names in scuba diving manufacturing, who can't wait to show the Divers Ready audience all of their new and exciting products for 2019, moving into 2020. So stay tuned for all those videos to come. And in the comments below, if you're heading to DEMA, let us know if you're going there, because we'd love to meet up with you too, say hi. Otherwise, just stop us on the exhibit floor. We'll be wearing these swanky t-shirts, and it'd be great to meet you. But without further ado, let's get the Q&A started. I'm gonna try and get through as many questions as possible. Two quick disclaimers before we do. Number one, if we don't get to your question, I do apologize. We received way more than we can cover in a 10 or 12 minute video. We will do another Q&A, and I will try and use as many of the questions from this round in that video, which will probably be Q1 next year, I would imagine. Disclaimer number two, I'm sorry if I butcher your name. Okay, let's dive straight in. Question number one, Hobbyman UK asks, what's your opinion on side mount versus twin set? And here we see the YouTuber in his natural environment, instantly regretting asking for questions from his audience. What's my opinion on side mount versus twin set? I think what you're trying to ask me here is which do I prefer, and I'm not going to answer that question because it's not an either or choice. That's like asking if I prefer hammers or screwdrivers. They're both tools to do a job. If I need to knock a nail in the wall, I'm going to choose a hammer. If I need to drive a screw in, I'm going to use a screwdriver. I don't subscribe to this philosophy of being one or the other. Side mount is great for certain types of diving. Back mount is great for other types of diving. For example, I tend to dive more back mount because here in South Florida, it's easier to don and get in the water off of a boat, and easier to get through narrow vertical hatches and corridors that we're used to when we penetrate the wrecks down here. So for me, I use back mount more. That's not a slight on the side mount. That's me picking the best tool for the type of diving I'm most commonly doing. Of course, if I lived up in cave country up in North Florida, I'd probably be a side mount diver. But unless they discover shipwrecks or sharks in caves, it's not gonna happen. Hobbyman, thanks for your question. Next up, we have Victor at playerox_VE. Solo diving, have you done it? Tips, question mark. Yes, I have done solo diving. In fact, we made a video for this channel called Solo Diver versus the InstaBuddy. I'll link that up above. In that video, I talk about the difference between being a trained solo diver, going through a course that teaches you about self-rescue and the importance of redundancy, over just being a recreational diver who goes diving alone. That is not solo diving. That is dangerous recreational diving. My approach to solo diving is very similar to my approach to all dives, and that's to be as self-reliant as possible and have as much redundancy and training as possible, that if I ever need assistance underwater, hopefully I can help myself out of the jam before having to rely on my buddies, which in most cases are students. Hope that answers your question, Victor. Definitely recommend a solo diver course if that's something you're interested in pursuing. Next up, we have Matt Holton. At Mr. Matthew Holton, names have been easy so far, thank you for that. I have secondhand kit from my dad. Once I pass my DM, should I buy a head-to-toe package from a retailer or from the first job as a DM with a discount? Well, first off, Matthew, congratulations on getting secondhand kit from your dad. I haven't inherited anything from my family because I'm the only one on my side of the family who scuba dives. Yeah. True story. When you become a dive master, you are crossing over into the professional realm. So yes, it is probably time to ditch your dad's secondhand gear and kit yourself out head to toe in nice new modern gear to put forward a professional image. So congratulations on taking that idea. As for whether you should go for a package deal or wait until you get employee discount at a dive center, a couple of thoughts on that. The package deals are great. You will save a ton of money. However, you will be tied to one brand. Now, if that brand makes your ideal mask and fins and BCD and regulator, then that's great, go for it. But the chances of that happening are slim. So what I've done in the past is buy a package deal and then keep the pieces I want from it and sell the other ones on at a very slight loss, brand new with tags still on it. And that way I'm still saving money overall on the deal. Now, you also asked about how employee discount works. And most dive centers that have a retail operation will want to incentivize their crew to be head to toe in the brands that they sell. It's good for them because you become a walking mannequin, and it's good for the brands themselves because you become an ambassador because you're using that gear and you can tell your clients, your students, and the potential customers in that store why you like the equipment that you're diving. Makes total sense, and normally they will offer you great pricing, but again, you'll be tied to that brand. What if you move from that shop to another shop later in your career? Are you gonna have to reinvest in your gear? Probably, but to be honest, as a dive professional, you know, if you don't like buying scuba gear, I can't help you. Oh no, more dive equipment. Matt, thanks for your question, I hope that helps. Next up, we have T. Keach at Keach97. What is the best way to pack and fly with your whole dive kit for trips abroad? Okay, so we did actually tackle this in a video we made for Scuba Diver Magazine, which I'll link up above there. But that was focused mainly on like a weekend trip or a short getaway, and I used mainly my travel specific gear for that. You're talking about like a whole dive trip for trips abroad, long distance and so on. So let me give you a couple of tips that are not in that video. I've had the privilege of going to some of the more dodgy areas of the world to do scuba diving. And one thing I always consider there is what luggage I'm going to take. If I'm going to one of the more sort of dangerous or edgy areas of the world, I tend to avoid using luggage that has scuba manufacturers branding all over it, because you're basically just advertising that you have a bag full of expensive gear, and that can make you a target for thieves. Next up, I mix my dive gear, my clothing, my wash kit, everything all in one bag as much as possible. So I make use of all the space. I'll roll t-shirts up, shove them into fin pockets, roll rash guards up and put them in my mask box, mix my saver dive kit with my wash kit, and just to get in there in the least amount of space. So don't feel the need that you need to have one bag for clothing, one bag for dive gear and so on. Just put your clothing in and around your dive gear and make best use of all the space that you possibly can. Thanks so much for your question, T. Keach. Moving on, we have John Horrell. At John Acola asks two very different questions. What are your thoughts on liveaboard safety following the tragedy in California? And what are your top five books for the diver's library? What are my thoughts on the liveaboard tragedy in California? Well, obviously a tragedy. And since you asked that question, John, actually we had another incident in the Red Sea on an Egyptian liveaboard, the Aggressor, just last week where there was a fire and one person passed away. So I'd like to kind of compare and contrast those two incidents. You have one incident in California where all the crew survived and all of the guests perished, versus the one in Egypt where there was a fire on board a liveaboard and everybody except one guest survived. If what we're hearing about all the crew being asleep, nobody being on watch, that goes against everything you're taught as a crew member. And you might not know this about me, but I actually spent 10 years working at sea. I've done all those training courses, STCW, watch keeping, safety, security, firefighting, first aid, all the stuff you have to know if you're gonna work on a ship that has passengers staying on board overnight. And that can be anything from like a catamaran in the Whitsundays to a cruise ship that carries 6,000 passengers. All crew members need that basic training. So if it's the case that in California, they had no crew members on watch, all the crew were asleep, all the passengers were asleep, a fire breaks out, the crew survive, all the passengers die, there is a responsibility there. You are liable, and I would expect severe sentencing to be passed down. Okay, on to a more cheery topic. What are five books I recommend for every scuba diver's library? Well, first off, you have the series of Reef Fish, Reef Creature, and Coral Identification, written by Paul Heumann and his collaborators Ned Deloach and Les Wilk. These are essential handbooks for the diver, because you come up from a dive, what was that fish? It's in those books, and you can buy them geographically relevant to the region that you live in. So definitely recommend those. Next up, you have probably the first autobiography by a genuine rock star of scuba diving, Jill Hynes, Into the Planet. I'm about that far away from finishing it. I'm thoroughly enjoying it. It's a real page turner, and I'm hoping that Jill will sign my copy at Dima next week. Also, Sylvia Earle's book, Sea Change. It's a love letter to the ocean by the undoubted ambassador for the Blue Planet. So that is a fantastic book that every diver should read. If you're looking to further your diver education beyond course manuals, I would recommend two books by Mark Powell, An Intro to Technical Diving, or Technical Diving and Introduction, I think it's actually called, and Deco for Divers. And last but not least, let me see. I think I'm gonna have to throw in there a book by National Geographic called 50 Places to Dive Before You Die. That is like a hand-built bucket list for all scuba divers. So I hope that helps you fatten out your diving library. Enjoy those recommendations. Thank you for your questions, appreciate it. Next up we have @backrugger asks, how old are you? I am. Dee Dee asks, what's in the yellow and red boxes behind you in the office? My money is on camera gear, but I'm not sure and it's killing me. Well, Dee Dee, let's have a look. In the yellow box I have not camera gear. It's my nitrox analyzer. This box is actually orange, it's not red. You're right, it's camera gear, it's my GoPro set. Unless you meant that red box that's on my desk over there, I can't talk about what's in that red box and I can't tell you why. Next up, Gloria Dayton 3 asks, how much dive gear do you own? You always seem to be in different gear each video. Do you have a favorite piece? Gloria, what do you want me to say here? Like, pick a favorite piece. How much dive gear do we own? Tons. We own so much dive gear that we've ran out of space in this house and are moving to a bigger house that has a detached garage that will become my studio and dive locker, and I will build the greatest dive locker the world has ever seen. 99% of the dive gear in this house has been collected over a long dive career, and we paid full retail price for it. We are at a stage now with this channel where equipment manufacturers are sending us gear to review, and that is an honor and a privilege, but we are running out of space. I know, boo-hoo, the guy with the free dive gear, but it is, no, seriously, it's a problem. Do I have a favorite piece of dive gear? I get asked that quite a bit. I don't have a great answer for you, because how do you compare like your favorite fins to your favorite regulator? But one piece of kit that I've really enjoyed using and I'm happy to have added to my collection in the last 2 years are the lights by Light and Motion. So these little badges here, which are just killer bright LED. I've you know, taken them inside of wrecks, beaten them up. They charge super fast. They have battery level indicating LEDs. I use them for video. I use them as my primary torch. They have a burn time of over 90 minutes on high, a couple of thousand lumen. I mean, they've really impressed me. Not a sponsored video. Honest recommendation, very much love Light and Motion lights. So I will say that is my favorite, but ask me tomorrow and I could give you a completely different answer. Thank you, Gloria. Next up we have Tom K. Why did you start YouTube and what channels do you follow? Thank you, Tom. I actually know this young gentleman because he comments on all our videos, and I appreciate you watching, Tom. He's a young lad, he's newly open water certified, and he's just living his best life. More power to him. Why did we start YouTube? Long story short, my wife had to have a surgery earlier this year and needed a couple of months at home to convalesce and recover, and I couldn't go off diving for 12 hours a day, so I kind of put a pause on the whole dive instruction thing for a few months so I could take care of her. But I'm not very good at kind of sitting around and twiddling my thumbs, so I decided to take this head full of useless scuba knowledge and archive it and make videos, and I started to throw them up on YouTube and you guys started watching them, and I want to say thank you very much for that, because it's been the strangest trip so far. 4,000 plus subscribers in 6 months. Thank you, each and every one of you. We really enjoy making videos for you, and more than that, it's the interaction with the community, and we're going to keep doing it. So yeah, that's the thing. As for my favorite channels, I think you asked what channels do I follow. Well, Tom, if you're talking about scuba diving channels, my favorites are as follows. Paul Nell, The Waterline Academy, Mateus Labo, who has the channel Mateus Labo,
Brilliant for underwater photography, underwater videography, hints and tips, as is Vanessa Carracare. We featured her in our video about five women divers on YouTube who rocked for Paddy's International Women Dive Day. So check out her channel. I also follow Backscatter for camera gear and reviews and just a lot of knowledge about hints and tips and filming techniques underwater. Really good channel there. Let me see, who else do I follow YouTube wise? If you're talking about non-diving, then I would say the DSLR Shooter, Gerald Undone, and Make Art Now are three of my favorite YouTube channels. So I will link all of those YouTube channels in the description of this video below. Tom, thank you so much for your question. I hope that answered it. Again, apologies, ladies and gentlemen, if I didn't get to your question. I feel like we tackled as many as we could in the time and a broad range of subjects. I feel like just, we tackled some information here. Thank you so much to everyone who submitted your question. If you haven't done so already, don't forget to hit that subscribe button. It really means the world to us. It helps this channel to grow and it helps us to keep making videos to make you a better scuba diver. You know how it works by now. Just over here, I'll put some other videos that you can watch of ours, and below there is a great big subscribe button if you haven't clicked it already. And let us know in the comments below if you're heading to DEMA. It would be great to see you there. Until next time, my name is James. This was your Divers Ready video for this week. Dive safe, dive often.